It's my pleasure to present the topic about the CT coronary as regards the anatomy, the technique, and the diagnostic information revealed from this imaging modality. First of all, we started imaging of CT coronary on machines of 16 multi-detector CT with reconstruction thickness of 1 millimeter, but now we have the era of 64 multi-detector CT and above up to 640, we have reconstruction thickness of 0.5 millimeter. So we have upgrading in the information revealed from this imaging modality. In order to prepare the patient, we have to put in mind that we have to evaluate moving organ and we cannot stop this moving organ. So we need the CT machine to move with the same velocity as this organ. So how can we do this? By reducing the motion artifact. In other words, by reducing the heart rate by using some medication like beta blocker or calcium channel blocker. So now we can have slow heart and machine that can move with the velocity of the heart. So in correlation to each other, they are stable. So we can have imaging, good imaging and good details. Our technique must be ECG gated. Our technique must be on 64 multi-detector CT and above, not below that. We have enhanced contrast technique so we can differentiate between the lumen of the blood vessel, the coronary, the soft plaque, the calcified plaque. We have other advantages rather than evaluation of the coronary arteries. First of all, we have non-invasive technique. With this non-invasive technique, we can exclude patients who are presented with chest pain, which is not typical for ischemic heart disease. They are elective cases. We don't need to rush for the cath room to stent these patients. We have high likelihood to be false positive patients, so we need non-invasive technique to evaluate the coronaries. Not coronary only, we can also do pulmonary angio, aortic angio, and we can evaluate the cardiac thrombi if we have. So we have what's called triple rule out technique to rule out the most common causes of acute chest pain in emergency setting: the pulmonary embolism, the aortic dissection, the coronary artery disease. This with a sub-millisievert dose, so the radiation hazards by the machine is very low. Also, we can evaluate the lung state. So the patient presented with acute chest pain or chest pain, chronic or acute chest pain. So the patient will not say, I have coronary disease. He says, I have acute chest pain. What about the lung causes or the extra cardiovascular causes of chest pain, like pneumonia, like bronchogenic carcinoma, like pleurisy, pericarditis? These can be evaluated also by the CT coronary in the same imaging setting. The role of acute chest pain of CT coronary in acute chest pain in certain patients who have low to intermediate likelihood coronary artery disease, the enzymes are not very elevated, very high, and non-ST segment elevation myocardial infarction. So 50% of acute chest pain with non-ST segment changes and equivocal enzyme assessment will have negative study, will have normal coronary or no significant lesions. 31% will have non-obstructive plaque. Only 20% will have a significant stenosis that need intervention. So we can exclude about 81% of patients from catheterization. How we assess the likelihood? By assessment of the risk factors like hypertension, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, smoking, age, we can categorize the patient into high likelihood and low to intermediate likelihood. So we have established role for CT coronary in acute chest pain conditions. And we have established classification for the patient with acute chest pain and chronic chest pain, of course. Now we need to say that CT coronary is a good negative test. So negative CT coronary, we have to do nothing for the patient. Or you have to assess the other possibilities of chest pain, like pneumonia, pericarditis, whatever. While in case of positive CT coronary artery, we need further management for the patient, either in the form of further diagnostic tests, like functional assessment of the myocardial perfusion, like SPECT, like MRI stress, or PET-CT, or fractional flow reserve, which can be done by either the CT or the cath. Or we have significant plaque, so we need management directly. We need to implant a stent or plan for CABG. We need to know before we need to have a look about the findings. We need to know the anatomy of the CT coronary. It's a little bit similar to the anatomy of the cerebral circulation. In the cerebral circulation, we have two major arteries, the vertebrobasilar system and the carotid system. In CT coronary, or in coronary, we have two major systems, the right system and the left system. The left system is short and it is branching into left anterior descending that reach the apex of the heart, and left circumflex artery that takes a curved course around the left ventricle. The right system is long system. It reaches the inferior surface of the heart and it is end by branching into posterolateral branch and posterior descending artery in 85% of patients. This is the CT images. The aorta gives the left main coronary, which is branching into left anterior descending that reached the apex, and left circumflex that takes a curved course around the left ventricle, and the right coronary system that takes a curved course around the right ventricle. This is the inferior surface of the heart. If we have what's called right dominant circulation, in 85% of population, we have RCA gives PDA or posterior descending artery and posterolateral branch. We have what's called also left dominant circulation. In this case, we have left circumflex giving posterior descending artery and posterolateral branch. In 5% of population, we will have what's called codominant circulation. So we have right coronary artery give PDA and left circumflex give posterolateral branch. We can have 3D images for the surgeons. We can have what's called multi-planar reformat imaging that can track the coronary artery around 360 degrees. So we can assess the lumen, we can have a top view over the lumen, over the region of stenosis and plaque. So it is a little bit like driving a car. You can't see all the dimensions of the car, but you have to put in your mind the 3D planning of the car in order to drive. This is the images of a patent normal right coronary artery in the form of curved multiplanar reformat. And this is the left main system. This is the normal view of left circumflex. This is the normal view of coronary arteries. And this is the 3D reformat. First of all, we do calcium scoring. If you have high calcium scoring beyond 1000, so you don't have to inject contrast in the patient. You don't have to go forward for the CT coronary. Actually, this patient sure will have a significant plaque. You need to refer this patient back to the clinician and ask for catheterization. If you have low calcium score, this is not meaning that you have free patient, because we have what's called soft plaque, which could be significant or total in zero calcium score. The other value of calcium score is assessment of the lungs. So we can exclude the other extracardiovascular causes of acute chest pain. This is the images of calcium before contrast administration. We assess the amount of calcium in correlation to the age of the patient, so we can have a statistical analysis of the risk of development of coronary artery disease based on calcium only. Again, we have what's called soft plaques, so we need to inject patient even if we have zero calcium score. This is, does not exclude that patient may have coronary artery disease. Our techniques, what's called the retrospective technique, in which X-ray is on all over the cardiac cycle, systole and diastole, so we can have images throughout all the cardiac phases during contraction and relaxation. Also, we have more X-ray exposure, so we give more dose to the patient. Also, we have what's called prospective, in which we give X-ray in a certain phase of the cardiac cycle. Mostly the diastole in coronary artery assessment and the systole in congenital heart disease assessment. We have less X-ray dose in the prospective images, but we have a drawback in the prospective images. What's called the motion artifact. We may have motion artifact that affects the course of the caliber or the images of the coronary artery in certain phase. This motion artifact is not found in the other phase, so we need to cover all phases in order to exclude this motion artifact effect. In my opinion, in this era of iterative reconstruction and care dose and the challenges how to reduce the amount of X-ray given by the machine, we reached to sub-millisievert dose actually. Try the retrospective scanning technique, especially if your patient is arrhythmic. Again, like the carotid circulation, plaques below 50% are insignificant, plaques from 50 to 70% are borderline, plaques beyond 70% are significant. This is the axial view of a totally occlusive plaque. This is a multiplanary format of significant mixed plaque. We can see the soft material, fat and fibrous tissue, and the calcified dot. This is the multiplanary format of a significant mixed plaque also. Again, here we have a focal soft plaque. We have no calcified materials in this plaque, but it is significant or total occlusive plaque. It is a short plaque. You need to assess the components of the plaque, either calcified or soft, the length of the plaque, the severity of the plaque, and the distal runoff after the plaque. This is a totally occlusive soft plaque. And here we have multiple calcified plaques. Here we have a mixed plaque. Soft plaque is more risky than calcified plaques. Again, we have a common language, what's called CAD-RAD system. Assessment of a stent. We have a wide spectrum of metal stent and drug eluting stents and bioabsorbable stent. In case of a stent, we don't have to assess the risk of coronary artery diseases by calcium scoring. Actually, the patient developed cardiac disease, coronary disease, and he needed to have a stent implantation. So, if we have any materials, I mean plaque material, inside the stent above 50% narrowing, we have significant stent restenosis. The stents which are beyond the lumen of 3 millimeter diameter only can be assessed, while stents below 3 millimeter diameter cannot be evaluated by CT coronary. The new era is bioabsorbable stents. The stent scaffold the coronary artery lumen and we dilate the site of stenosis by the angioplasty, while we avoid the foreign body reaction of the stent. It is absorbed all over the time. This is an example of patent stent, and this is an occluded, totally occluded stent. We have a good distal runoff beyond the totally occluded stent. It is a retrograded flow through the coronary connections, the coronary anastomosis. The open heart surgeries, the CABG assessment. We have multiple techniques for CABGs, but the major technique is by connecting the subclavian artery, the left subclavian artery, by its branch, left internal mammary artery, to the distal LAD. And we connect 2 venous grafts or 1 venous graft or more venous grafts to the other arteries. First of all, LIMALAT, left internal mammary artery connection to the distal left anterior descent. We track the course from the subclavian artery through the left internal mammary and down to the distal portion of the left anterior descent. We need to check the patency of the graft, the distal portion distal to the anastomotic point. We need to check if we have a graft complication like graft spasm, graft thrombosis, graft plaques. Actually, edema is, or arterial grafts in general, is durable for the pressure of the arterial system, not like the venous grafts, which are not durable for a long period for support the arterial pressure. This is an example of venous graft. The venous caliber is more dilated than the arterial caliber early after the cabbage, but later on what's called arterialization happens, and this arterialization may little bit narrowing the caliber of the venous graft. As lima, we have rima. Rima is right internal mammary artery, which is connected to the distal right coronary artery or the posterior descending artery. Here we have a venous graft, and this venous graft is connected to the obtuse marginal artery, but distal to the anastomotic point, we have a significant soft plaque. Here we have a totally occluded graft with poor distal runoff. In this case, we need to assess the viability of the myocardium in order to say we can do any management, any surgical or interventional management for this patient, or drugs is enough. It's not about the caliber only. Also, we have certain parameters for assessment of the significance of the plaque. We have what's called culprit or vulnerable plaques. In case of vulnerable plaques, we need to say to the clinician that we have unstable plaques. Please take care. We have four criteria in the coronary artery system for assessment of vulnerability. First of all, the soft material, the density of the plaque, the soft plaque, the fatty plaque, the plaque density below 30 is vulnerable. Stenosis is not everything. The other character is positive remodeling. Any artery, any arterial system starts narrowing or starts plaque formation from outside to inside. We have first positive remodeling, thickening of the wall of the blood vessel, then the plaque encroaches on the lumen. So, positive remodeling is a thickening in the coronary artery wall that may encroach on the lumen. Napkin ring sign. Napkin ring sign means acute breakdown in the plaque material. So we have a core necrotic portion of the coronary plaque. We have fibrous portion, we have patent coronary artery. This is a vulnerable plaque. Again, this is a non-contrast image. We have here, with a contrast image, we have a necrotic core. A very risky plaque. This is the pathology of the napkin ring sign. Spotty calcification. The fine dots of calcification on top of soft plaque increase the likelihood of plaque degradement. Again, the lipid core density below 30 pounds filled unit, the positive remodeling, the thickening of the coronary artery wall, spotty calcification on top of soft plaque, napkin ring sign, acute plaque breakdown, acute necrotic core. These four criteria of vulnerability in coronary artery disease. We can have other character which is called ulcerative plaque. Ulcerative plaques are vulnerable plaques. We have also what's called myocardial perfusion analysis. It's not only about the assessment of the calibers and the stenosis degree of the coronaries. We can also do some functional imaging like myocardial perfusion analysis. After giving adenosine or dobutamine, we can have more images about the reaction of contrast to the myocardium, about the how much contrast uptaken by the myocardium. And the contrast is indicator for the blood flow. This is the map of myocardial perfusion assessment. Here in the blue color, we have reduced myocardial perfusion, reduced myocardial blood flow. While here in the yellow and the green and red color, we have preserved myocardial blood flow. So this lesion in the LED system is a significant lesion and needs intervention. As our image for the stress CT, we have here hypoperfusion. The contrast couldn't reach all parts of the myocardium in the LCX territory. So we have a significant lesion that needs intervention. The cutoff point of normal myocardial perfusion is 75 milli for each 100 milli myocardium per minute. The creme de la creme, fractional flow reserve. Fractional flow reserve is actually a cath parameter. We can assess this parameter during catheterization by assessment the pressure in the distal portion, distal to the plaque, and the pressure proximally to the plaque, and the ratio between the distal pressure and proximal pressure is called the fractional flow reserve. What's mean by fractional flow reserve? If I say that I have fractional flow reserve of 75%, this means that the amount of blood flow reached these certain segments of coronary, this territory of coronary, is 75 of its normal value. What is the significant fractional flow reserve? I mean, what is the significant reduction that needs intervention in the amount of blood flow? It is below 75%. So if you have 50% fractional flow reserve, that means that you have blood amount 50% of the normal blood that should be reached, should be delivered to this territory. So I mean, I have a significant amount. While above 75 is preserved fractional flow reserve, you need only medical treatment. This is an example. Here we have fractional flow reserve of 93%. So it is a preserved fractional flow reserve. Now we can assess the fractional flow reserve with CT, not only with the catheter. We can also assess it with the CT, which increases the positive predictive value of CT coronary. This is an example. We have obstructive stenosis. This obstructive stenosis leads to a fractional flow reserve of 58%, means we have significant plaque. We need to intervention. Again, here we have 87%. This is not a significant plaque, so we can manage a patient medically. Some patients cannot be exposed to the magnetic field, either in case of cochlear implant, some MRI incompatible pacemakers. So we can do the viability assessment by contrast enhanced CT, by injection of contrast, and we wait 5 to 10 minutes. Then we have delayed images from the myocard. We can have similar images to the MRI. It's not similar, I can say less accurate, but informative in the same time. This is the MRI images. And this is the CT image. The other value of coronary CT is the assessment of coronary course. We have what's called malignant and benign abnormal course of coronary. Malignant course means that we have an interarterial course, a course between the aorta and pulmonary artery. And in addition, we have narrow ostium of coronary. So we have two conditions for malignant course. This patient is vulnerable for sudden cardiac death. And this patient is vulnerable for occlusion or obstruction by a trivial ostial plaque. So we need to do a surgery for this patient. We need to do an intervention for this patient in order to correct this course. Other courses, like the prepulmonic course, is significant only in case of other surgeries for the heart, like correction of tetralogy of Fallot. In case of correction of tetralogy of Fallot, we need to manipulate the RVOT. So we can't do a liberal manipulation for the RVOT while we have a prepulmonic coronary artery. This is an example for malignant LAD. We have slit-like origin, narrow ostium. It is abnormal origin from the right coronary sinus and abnormal course of the left main coronary in between the pulmonary artery and the aorta. The last issue is the coronary artery fistula. The most common fistula between the coronaries and the right system, but we can also fistulas with the venous system. Thank you.